little bit? There, perfect. Thank you. Okay, great. So here we are, Call to Freedom. We're counting down our Reformation celebration this year, October 31st, 2017, and churches all over the world are preparing for this one. And so we keep all the churches, in prayer, especially the churches that are Bible teaching churches who stand up for the Word of God. This January 19th, we will be having a prayer and worship service here. We'll have worship music from 7 to 8, and then prayer from the remainder of that time till midnight. You're welcome to drop in, stay for a few minutes, come to 7 and 8 for the worship, come from 7 to midnight. I'll be here from 7 to midnight. And we're praying for our country. We don't endorse political parties, we don't endorse candidates, but we do endorse our country. And so we're here to pray for the good of our country, for all the leaders, for all the government. We have local civil government, we have city government, we have county government, we have statewide government, we have federal government, we have the legislature, we have the judicial branch, we have the executive branch. Government goes all over the place, and so we don't just hold true to one form or one person at all. We pray for our entire country and for all those people who've been called to serve in our country. So we'll be praying on the 19th because the inauguration is on the 20th, 9 o'clock California time. And so we'll be praying for our country and for all our leaders in all form of government. So you're welcome to join us. If you're in a small group that evening and you can't make it, please pray in your small group. If you're at home or at work or someplace that evening, please, during this time, sometime between 7 and midnight on the 19th, pray there for your country. And so we believe in the power of prayer. The Bible says, if my people will humble themselves before me, I will heal their land. You know, God gives us that promise. In James, we get this promise. The effectual prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. Elijah was a man, a nature just like us. Elijah, just like us. And he prayed earnestly that it would not rain. And it didn't rain on the earth for 3 years and 6 months. And then he prayed again, and the sky poured forth rain, and the earth produced its fruit. Well, we've been praying, and I think California is getting some rain coming in. So all those who've been praying, your prayers are heard. And I think God is good. So prayer works. We believe in prayer, and we will be praying for our country on the 19th. 2017, we're thinking, what a great way to start off 2017 is with the very essence of our faith, keeping the resurrection in mind to pull us through, to guide us and lead us into 2017. What a great way to begin 2017. Often at Easter, there's just a lot of stuff that goes into Easter, and Easter Sunday becomes, well, it's a major celebration. We talk about the resurrection on Easter Sunday, and after that, it kind of, well, we're launching right off into summertime and plans and everything, but the essence of our faith, the very reason for our being here, is the resurrection. So we want to take some time to really focus on what God has done through the resurrection of Christ. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus doesn't change. Our country may change. Jesus doesn't change. Our culture may change. Jesus doesn't change. We may change. But Jesus never changes. The same yesterday, today, and forever. So it's up to us to get on board with what God is doing, not for God to follow us along as to what we are doing. And so we're looking at a guiding scripture this year, and a good one is 3 John 1 and 2. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. What a great guiding scripture for us to meditate on this year. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things prosper, and be in health, to prosper in health, just as your soul prospers, even for our soul to prosper. And so it's good to meditate on good things, and this is a great one to meditate on. Goal, if you think about what's going to be the end of 2017, I think a good goal is at least to feel better than we do now, right? To feel 10 to 100 times better than we do right now, to think about prospering, to think about how can I feel better in my body, in my mind, in my spirit, and work towards that. and to pray. Say, God, help me be better. Help me prosper in body, soul, and spirit. And God answers prayers. And so he will do that if we ask him. And so to be part of that. And how do we do that? It's through using scripture, using prayer and worship, using fellowship. These are some of the tools that God has given us to prosper. And so to use the ones that he's given us, fellowship, prayer, worship, scripture, will help us prosper, help us to be in good health as our soul prospers. We're launching a new program, a PhD program, prophecy, which is preaching, healing, and deliverance. We're expecting good things from God this year. Prophecy, which is the preaching of the word, the sharing the word, healing, expecting good things, healing from God, and also deliverance. Deliverance from the things that we've been bound to and chained to, maybe for years and years, we want to get free from. God wants us to be free from that. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Freedom. Because Christ has already done things for us. We started talking about this last week. The riches that Christ has given us already. That he brings us a meaning in life that suffering cannot take away. Suffering can't get in between us and what Christ has done. A contentment he's given us. Not based on circumstances, but God's spirit. A unique identity that is received. We receive our identity. We don't achieve our identity. And this unsurpassed freedom, which we'll be talking about today, to this humble confidence Christ has given us, a humble confidence that we can do what God has called us to do, that we are absolutely loved without any condemnation, any shame, 100% love. We have this humble boldness from Christ in a future hope. That will take us through into 2017. For the futures is how we experience the present. The future hope, what God has already given us, comes into our present and changes our present through the future. And this is done through the resurrection of, if there was no resurrection of Christ, we wouldn't be here. There would be no churches. There would be no America. There would be nothing. This world would not exist as we know it without the resurrection. Everything we do depended and depends on and still continues to depend on the resurrection of Christ. It's a cornerstone of our faith. It's the reason that the Bible exists. The resurrection of Christ is everything. It's everything for us. It's everything. Thomas, we remember last week that Thomas says, you know, Lord, unless I can touch and see the holes in your hand and touch your side, I'm not going to believe. And we can call him the doubting Thomas, but Thomas had exactly right, because that's the cornerstone of our faith, the resurrection. And he wanted to be 100 absolutely percent sure of that. And the Lord came back. And he could have said, Thomas, well, you had enough. I showed you enough. But the Lord comes back even to Thomas to show him, not only him, but for us as well. And the disciples then could go out and express and share their faith 100% confident that the resurrection is true, is a fact. It's very true. And so even in our words today, we see that the resurrection guides our hope and our leading, where it leads us today. And so all the disciples and many, many people, over 500, it says, saw the risen Christ. It wasn't just the 12. It says over 500 people saw the resurrection Christ in Scripture. And that is the word that we share. This hope of the resurrection is personal, is certain, it's wonderful. It's personal because Jesus came back and showed himself individually to people that knew him, people that he loved. He said, look, it's me. This is really true. It's a fact. This is God working. Isn't this for each of us? It's personal, it's certain. It's so certain that a child can understand this. It's so certain that a child can understand what this means. Absolutely certain, and it's wonderful. It's beyond anything. It's the most wonderful thing we can ever talk about or ever experience in this world is the resurrection of Christ. Absolutely the most wonderful thing we can talk about. And for us, it's the receipt. It's the receipt of what God's done for it. The gift he's given us is like the receipt. It's like going into a store and exchanging something. Maybe you got for a gift for Christmas. It doesn't matter, you didn't buy it. You have the receipt. You own it. You can exchange it on a different color, different size, because you own it. The receipt for us, the resurrection, We own that gift. He's given that gift to us. Paid in full through the blood of Christ on a cross. The resurrection is our gift from God. So today, the second part of the resurrection story, we want to talk about the freedom in Christ. How the resurrection not only gives us hope, but gives us freedom. And freedom for us is the baseline for America. It's what we consider Americans to be all about, is freedom. It's such an important thing in our culture. But freedom is so misunderstood in our culture. In Galatians, Paul writes, "For you were called to freedom, brethren. Not only do not turn your freedom into an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another." Wait. Freedom doesn't mean serving someone else. Freedom means I can do what I want, where I want, what I want, when I want. But that's not freedom, as Paul tells us. We are free to serve one another. Free to serve one another. What is freedom? Well, for us, for many people, freedom might be in the islands, unlimited vacation. It goes on and on. I can eat, I can drink, I can be merry, I can just kind of be in a tropical island. It goes on and on. That would be complete freedom for many people. Just out there, don't have to work. I'm just kind of just taking in the sunshine, drinking the drinks, eating the eats, and just kind of relaxing and just kind of being out in this tropical paradise forever. But that's not freedom. In fact, we couldn't even sustain that lifestyle. Freedom is not eating whatever we want endlessly and drinking whatever we want and doing mindless things forever. It's a good vacation, but that's not freedom. It's nothing to do with freedom. When the children of Israel were bound working for Pharaoh, they had all kinds of laws and all kinds of rules. They had a very rigorous schedule and very limited resources. But God called them out of that slavery. And what's the first thing he does? He gives them laws. I'm bringing you out of bondage from Pharaoh. But the first thing he does, the very first thing he does, is gives them 10 commandments to follow. And it wasn't only 10. It started with 10 and went out to 613. But it started with 10 because freedom is found in keeping the rules and keeping connected with God. To serve one another, to serve God, to be part of God's family, to belong. To belong. That's freedom. Freedom is not doing what we want, where we want, being free from relationships. Freedom is being connected with Christ. Jesus says, if the Son of Man sets you free, you will be free indeed. Free to do what? Free to serve. Free to serve. And that's what we are called to. Free to be free from bondage of ourselves, from the lies in our minds that say we are sinners and self-absorbed and shamed and stupid and dumb and worthless. Free from that, but free to be children of God and to serve. We are free from that. We don't spend our time polishing our chains. Look at my chains. They're so shiny. We don't polish our chains. We ask God to set us free from our chains. And God does that. He sets us free. And God's trustworthiness was at stake with this resurrection. If Jesus wasn't raised, God would be less than God, wouldn't he? Because he didn't promise his word. He didn't fulfill what he said he was going to do. He showed up to be incomplete. So God's very faithfulness was at stake in the resurrection. But God came true in Christ. It says he can do what he's going to do and will do what he's going to do. So if he can do what he's going to do, if he does what he says he's going to do for Christ, then he will do what he says he's going to do for us. For it says that we too will be raised in a resurrection like Christ. And Jesus was raised up, which we are all witnesses, Peter says. We were all witnesses of this. This Jesus was raised up. This Jesus that was crucified for our sins was raised up. This Jesus who, in the very last chapter of Matthew, there's this little story here that they tried to say it's not true. And it says, that Jesus says to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren in Galilee, for I will come and see them." And just a few moments later, while they were going to spread the good news, it says, while they were on their way, some of the guard came into the city, reported this to the chief priest, what had happened. And when they assembled with the elders and consulted together, they gave large sums of money to the soldiers, saying, you are to say, his disciples came by night and stole him. They stole him away while you were sleeping. And if this should come to the governor's ears, you'll win him over and you'll keep out of trouble. And so they took the money and they did what they were instructed. And the story spread among all the Jews, even to this day. Nobody wants the resurrection story to be told or heard. They paid huge sums of money to keep this thing quiet, to say, the disciples stole the body. We don't want this resurrection story going around. The disciples stole the body. And that was a story to be told. But Paul says, if Christ has not been raised, our faith is worthless. We're still in our sins. There's no point. Our faith is worthless. We're still in our sins. Paul writes, otherwise, what will we do with those who are baptized for the dead? If the dead are not raised, why are they baptized for them? Why are we in danger in every hour? See, people were thinking, well, I'm being baptized because I know that my friends are going to heaven, so I want to be baptized with them. So when my family members go to heaven, I want to be baptized. I want to be with my family members. But if my family members aren't going to heaven, why should I be baptized? They're saying, what's the use in it? If there's no resurrection of the dead, why bother? And Paul says, yes, I agree. Why bother? If there's no resurrection of the dead, why bother? Because we're in danger every hour. But the truth is, the resurrection is true. It's a fact. It's true. And it's what our faith is built on, the resurrection. Where they're on their way. We already read this, so I'm going to go on with this. The resurrection is the basis of our faith. What will pull us through in 17, because it causes us to belong. We belong to this tribe, these people of the resurrection. I went with my family to Kansas City, and I was extremely encouraged. We went to Kansas City over break, and we saw 24,000 people, 24,000 people around the country who had given up their holiday, given up their Christmas vacation to come to Kansas City to pray and to worship. And I was amazed. There were seven Russian bishops there. People from all over the country came to pray, and they got up and were standing in line at 6 in the morning in the cold Kansas City weather, 6 in the morning outside the convention center, to get in line to pray and worship each and every day. Went from 6 in the morning, they were up till midnight, every day. Every day. Americans doing this, excited to do this, in line to do this, to pray and worship from all of our country. There's something going on in our country, something going on, and it's just beginning. And it's something good because people want to belong to the resurrected community. People are putting their faith out there for God, and they're trusting. So here's the question. Well, what if I'm content and with being consumed with what I'm doing now? Whatever I'm doing now is okay. I'm just content with it. Well, the answer to that is just give it time. Just give it time, because our contentment doesn't last very long, does it? With whatever we're doing, our contentment grows short, and only God can give our hearts contentment. Only God can. This is the owner's manual for us, because we were designed to be with God, to live with God, to be connected with God, to serve Him, to belong to Him, for our freedom is to serve God. Be on our own, give it time. Another question. Why would a God who made the universe care about what we think or what we even do? And isn't that the wonderful mystery? The God who made this vast, incredibly vast, complex universe would care about what we say or do. And isn't that the mystery? Isn't that the mystery of our faith? That God cares about what we think on a daily basis, what we do, who we are, what we think. And if we're in relationship with Him, that truly is the mystery, isn't it? For our hand goes in His hands. We belong to him as a child to a father. He sees us as family. We belong to him. We belong to God, and that is the mystery. And Peter writes, therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God so that at the right time he will lift you up. Throw all your cares on him, all your anxieties on him, because he cares for us. The God who made the universe cares about our little troubles, our big troubles. He cares about all our troubles. He cares about us. So Peter says, throw your anxieties, throw your cares on him, all your cares, because he cares about us. That's the kind of God we have. He's not an absent God. He's a caring God. God wants our hearts. Satan wants to mess with our minds. He wants to give us worries and troubles and things to fret about. But God wants to still our hearts. It keeps our hearts in peace, in perfect peace. So finally, after the resurrection, Jesus says, all authority in heaven has been given to Christ. On heaven and on earth has been given to him. There is no higher authority than Christ, not in heaven or on earth. So the resurrection, Christ was given all authority. There's nothing higher than what Christ has. It's been given to him. And why Christ? He has absolute authority and power over all things. He doesn't use that power to slay people. He doesn't go after subduing his enemy. There's time. He's calling all to repent, giving time for all to come to him and all to repent. And yet, while they still disbelieve for joy and were marveling, he said to them, have you anything to eat? Which is amazing. Jesus is standing outside with his disciples saying, look at me, feel me, touch me, and by the way, I'm hungry. The resurrection Christ is hungry. So what does that say for us? We get bodies. We get to eat again because we'll be resurrected in a likeness of his. We're not going to be raised as ghosts. We're not going to be these spirits flying around, joined to this big ball of energy. We'll be given bodies that are healed, bodies that never get sick, bodies still that can enjoy and taste at least food, which is amazing. How's God going to do this? Who knows? We don't know, but we're going to be there. Romans says, do you not know that you've been baptized into Christ? You were baptized into his death and buried with him in a baptism like his death in order that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too would walk in this newness of life. We don't have to wait. We can walk right now in 2017 in this newness of life, letting this hope of the resurrection, this freedom that we have, pull us into this year. Knowing that we can have a prosperous life, a healthy life. Our souls can prosper. We can prosper, unashamedly prosper, connected with God. Be free to pray and worship God and stand in the faith because we will be raised with him. And to have that confidence in our lives that we may be few, but we are mighty. We are mighty. Baptism is like it's like a ring that God gives us. It's an agreement. It says in baptism, we are joined together. We're part of God's family to be connected with him forever. That's why we celebrate the baptism of Christ today. We celebrate that oneness, that covenant that God has given us, that we're joined to him and we can live in joy. One more question. Why has our culture gone dark? Why has our culture really gone dark? Because many have lost their biblical theology. They've lost their faith. They're no longer committed to the eternal life principle that says we will stand before God one day and be accountable. We think our freedom lets us off the hook. But it doesn't. That's not what freedom is for. It's not off the hook freedom. It would be like a coach telling his football team, you guys get out there in the field and have some fun. Have some fun. Call the plays, whatever you want to do, call the plays. You don't even have to do the same thing. Just go out there and knock yourselves out. Those teams don't win. It's the ones who are working together, who are regimented, who work as one, as a team. God has called us to be part of his family. The resurrection is our incentive, it's our motivation, it's our calling, it's the pull that will get us through so we can not only thrive, but go way beyond that and prosper, be in health as our soul prospers, as John tells us. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in good health as your soul prospers. That's God's will for us to do that. So let's be those people. Let's be the prosperous people. Let's be people in good health. Let's be people whose souls are magnified and prosper for God. Let's have a mighty, mighty 2017. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.